No, not yet. Almost. Okay, we're good.
So I want you to get really familiar with this catchphrase. Experience your divinity through your humanity. There is a famous painting in the Sistine Chapel where God is breathing life into Adam. This painting represents how the divine spark, the God, lives within us, in the human flawed flesh. It is the story of Jesus. It has been told and retold time after time after time in different ways. I'm going to share a myth with you of the centaur, a particular centaur named Chiron. This symbol that looks like a P is the glyph for this particular mythological creature. If you've ever seen the movie Percy Jackson, you saw Pierce Brosnan play this character. He is half animal, half human. He had a huge camp where he would take all the gods' children and teach them, and then Percy went off and fought Medusa and did his thing. So that's the character we're talking about. First, let me tell you about centaurs. In mythology, centaurs were half animal, half human. However, they were rapists and they were alcoholics. This will be the lower nature. This will be the humanity. Why was Chiron different? Chiron different because he was given an opportunity to see his divine nature as a result of the gods taking sort of pity on him. So let me tell you a little bit about the story of his birth, which represents the story of yours. So in mythology, Chiron, his mother and his father were not married. His father was actually cheating on his wife, had sex with her, and they birthed Chiron. Now his father had shape-shifted from human image into horse because his mother was a horse. So they had sex, Saturn runs off, and his mother gives birth to the baby. When she sees the baby, this disgusting creature, half animal, half human, she abandons him. This is important. Every single one of us feels that we were abandoned. We all have abandonment issues. We call them different things. Some of us were actually physically abandoned. Your parents left you. Your parents walked away. That is more of the physical, real interpretation. However, we all symbolically interpret our abandonment. Abandonment starts the moment you realize that you are here to meet your parents' needs, step three, and your parents aren't here to meet your needs unconditionally. This is what we have in our psyche. My parents didn't love me unconditionally, therefore I was abandoned and I didn't get basic needs met. I said before, usually they can be sort of clustered into safety, protection, validation, or love needs. Maybe you have all of them, maybe you only have one or two. But your abandonment, your wound, your Chiron, the key to healing yourself, the key to bringing your purpose or your light into the world. I get that every day. What's my purpose? What's my purpose? Your purpose is to heal your Chiron. Own your divinity through your humanity, and then your life starts to unfold because you're meeting your needs. You're forgiving yourself for being flawed, forgiving your parents for not loving you unconditionally, and all is good. So all of us have in our psyche a certain way that we feel abandoned. In my line of work, because of my clinical skills, and what I invite you to recognize in yourself is how these show up. There's some very common ways, however, the masks that we wear will show them up skewed for different people. Safety. Safety means that you might be really into justice and political, you know, political themes. Safety might be that for a living, you're a security guard. You can see how our profession will reflect the need that was left unmet. Protection. Protection usually has to do with weight issues or monetary or financial issues or food. Maybe you're a chef. Validation tends to have to do with movement. Maybe you have problems with your legs or your knees. Or maybe you have adrenal fatigue. I'm talking about the physical symptoms, but also you have difficulty making choices. You really deliberate what you should do because you have a problem with trusting yourself to move forward and make a choice. And love needs shows up oftenly as codependent or enmeshment, where you're too much for the other person or your identity is wrapped up in the other. So these are very typical themes, and most of us have one of these, if not more. So this is how Chiron, or this abandonment, shows up in your life. So in astrology, we call this the primordial wound. You realize your parents don't love you unconditionally, therefore you understand you are flawed, you have a problem. And your whole job in life is to pretend you don't have that problem, so you do the opposite, 0 to 100, and you go into the world so organized, so disciplined, but really internally you're an absolute mess. So this is what we see. So why divinity through our humanity? I want to go back to that painting in the Sistine Chapel. The spirit needs the matter. God, whatever you see as God, needs you, needs your body. They need you to be the manifestation of the spirit, of the divine. So I channel spirit all the time. And what does spirit do? Gives the client a ritual. Why? So that they can take the change that they're doing, so to speak, in their realm, and bring it to the materialization in this person's life, so it can come into being, come into creation, second chakra. Where we have an issue with our humanity, I mentioned, was in the second chakra. But it's also where we birth things into materialization so that they can be. So a little bit more about the myth of Chiron. So Chiron's abandoned, and the gods look down at him, and they feel bad for him. They scoop him up, and they say, Chiron, we're going to adopt you. And they adopt Chiron, and he's so smart because he's evolved. The difference between the animal and the human is the fact that they have rationality, that we have a logical mind. What's happened is the emphasis on logic and intellect has gone awry in our country. It's all about logic and intellect, and that's how people are measuring their worth. One of the things I love about this new age of Aquarius and this internet revolution and the millennials is that they view things differently. They're getting their self-worth a little bit less attached to, let's say, the college degree, hence the gap year. The experience is what's opening them up to a broader world, hence the reflection in the internet and social media. So they adopt Chiron, he's so smart that they automatically are so grateful, and they say, Chiron, we're going to give you immortality. Remember, he was a father that was a god, Saturn, and his mother who was an animal. So he became a demigod. We are demigods. We have a quote unquote, not to take from Christianity, but a spiritual or divine father, if you will, and an earthly mother. In Greek mythology, we talk about Uranus and Mother Earth. That is another story, but it's all linked to why we are the demigod. On our way to being human, on our way to finding our way back up, like the Kabbalists say, up the tree of life, back to meet with our creator. So Chiron becomes immortal. He's grateful. Teaches all of the god kids philosophy, history, mathematics, algebra, chemistry. He's a genius. His favorite student is Hercules. This is an interesting concept. In astrology, Hercules is the warrior, Mars, and Chiron is the teacher. We will chase our ego. We will chase our goals. We will chase our masculine, the money, the doing, the goal orientation, the movements. Athletes chase medals because we want to cover our wound. What you chase tells me what wound you are trying to cover. So Hercules being his favorite student, Hercules is like, Chiron, we have to go save a bride who I was notified was going to be raped on her wedding day. Now Hercules, from one of his previous myths, had killed the Hydra. So he had this poison, and he would dip the poison, the arrow into the poison, and that poison would open a wound that would never heal. So they go off to save the bride, and accidentally, as Hercules is pulling his arrow, the arrow hits Chiron in the thigh. Important, in the thigh, second and third chakra level. This is the lower nature, the animal nature. The wound that will never heal is in your animal nature. It's why you try to hide it. It's why you try to give more in compassion, more to the other person than the judgment of greed and envy and things and selfishness of taking for yourself. We view our flesh as flawed, our animal desires as flawed, and we want nothing to do with them, so we try to cover them up. So now Chiron is in a lot of pain. Hercules, of course, feels horrible. And Chiron's like, I'm going to go around the world and see if somebody has an antidote for my wound. Hercules stays by his side. They knock on everyone's door. And every time that Chiron asks for help, the person says, I don't have any help for you, but can you help me? And because he's so smart and he's so well-versed in herbs and alternative medicine and essential oils and math and science, he has an answer for the person. This is what we know as the wounded healer. This is a big thing that we're seeing a lot. Everybody's a healer. We all are healers. Some people that are working in accounting are healers, and the people that are working as mechanics, just not only the spiritual gurus. We're all healers because we all have a wound that we're trying to ultimately heal, but we just don't know how to do it. It goes awry. After 50 years that Chiron is knocking on everyone's door, has traveled the world looking for an antidote to his poison, he decides to go back home. This is a very important message. We have three major key life sort of moments, 28 to 30, where we're given what's called in astrology Saturn, the cross we bear, usually a professional cross, or we have a family, or we buy a house and have a 30-year mortgage. At 40 to 42, where we have Uranus, which is our sexual liberation and our freedom. And at 48 to 50, where we have our Chiron return, which is our spiritual awakening. Now, this is sort of speeding up, but if you speak to people around that age, they tend to have impact in terms of their spiritual growth and understanding. Chiron goes back home, and he is like, what am I going to do? The spiritual awakening, which is the goal of the 48 to 52, which is no accident that that's exactly when the Chiron return happens in your astrological chart between 48 and 50, 52, depending on when you were born, is when you can find the answers within. When you stop knocking and asking someone else for help, when you start meeting your own needs that were abandoned, or the way you believed you were abandoned, and the needs that were never met in childhood. So what does Chiron do? He goes back to Olympus. He's a little depressed, and he's like, okay, how do I meet my own need? How do I finally heal my wound? And he remembered. He remembered that Prometheus, if you've ever been to Rockefeller Center, there's a beautiful gold statue of Prometheus, and he has the fire, a torch. Prometheus was sort of a defiant god. He stole fire from the gods and gave it to humans. This is extremely symbolic. Third chakra is the chakra of fire. Every chakra has an element. I talked about earlier the digestive fire that transforms. When a god gives the humans a capacity to transform via fire, we can't go wrong. We can't die. We can cook our food. We can transform our child into our adult. Our divinity, our humanity turns into divinity as we get closer to our creator. So he remembered that Prometheus had been punished by Zeus. And Zeus said to Prometheus, you're going to be attached to this rock, and every night you're going to have a vulture eat your liver. It'll heal during the day, and at night it will sort of be reopened, and the vulture will eat your liver. Until somebody decides to switch places with you and become mortal. And Chiron's like, that's my end. I'm going to let go of my immortality status, and I am going to switch places with Prometheus. So he found his own answer to his own issue, to his own healing, 48 to 52. He goes to Zeus, he tells Zeus his story, and Zeus says, absolutely, no problem. And what occurs is that Chiron gets attached to the rock. The vulture comes, eats his liver, and now he dies. The flesh dies. Obviously, the spirit never dies. And he found a way to heal his own issues. This is our story. We are wounded, abandoned healers and children. And what we're trying to do is find our way back home, our way back to Olympus with our own solution. The only way is to really get in touch with our animal nature, with the wound. That is what I call your humanity. The only way that you can experience your divinity is if you live in your body, if you experience your wounds, if you experience the flesh. Not if you try to hide them and put them away in a bad bucket. Like I mentioned before, if a client doesn't like her hands and I offer her a knife to cut up her hand, she's not going to do it. But you will do that in your psyche. And each and every one of us has a bad bucket. Your bad buckets hold your divinity. How can you shine your light without experiencing your abandon? Unless you get in touch with what makes you human, the pain that you experience, really, really own it, you're not going to be able to give it back, fourth chakra, to anyone. So that's why our identity, that's why our God or our intuition, our guidance, however you like to call it, is in the gut. I have a gut feeling. I mentioned before, the vagus nerve then goes up to the brain. So it is the gut that's informing us. It's the God, but where is it located? At the third chakra. So your God, your divinity, actually lives in your animal nature. It's divinity through your humanity. When you can get in touch with the seatbelt, with joining the good and the bad buckets, with your self-awareness, with your self-acceptance, own that. Heal your wound with your 48 to 52, keeping a boundary, meeting your own needs, having safe boundaries and rules in place. Then and only then do you give back up to the fourth chakra and find your way back home, so to speak. Liberating yourself of holding your parents and anyone else hostage about your abandonment, but rather have your spiritual awakening at whatever age that you do this. That is what means to experience your divinity through your humanity. And let me just take you back quickly before we end to the initial picture of the Sistine Chapel. God breathes life into Adam. Spirit needs the matter to animate. When you die, you're just a sack of bones. Your spirit leaves, and what's left is the flesh. It is the spirit needing this sack of bones so that it can do its work. Don't chop off your humanity or your divinity. Use them so you can really shine the light, so you can take Prometheus's torch and transform your life and that of others. Thank you.